this is one of the driest places on Earth. Sometimes it feels like being on the Moon or Mars.
During the day is a fantastic place, but during the night is absolutely astonishing.
Hi everybody, welcome back to the Journey Through the Extreme Universe. Today we have our latest webinar before the summer break. And what a better way to survive these high temperatures we have in some cities than going on a trip to the outer space, to our own galaxy. Today, our mission commander, Sofia Ventura, will talk about the most powerful and exotic sources that our galaxy hosts beyond standard stars. And we're going to learn also how the City Observatory is going to observe them. But before introducing Sofia, let me remind you, if you have comments, questions, if you have some curiosity that it's there in your mind, share it with us. Send us a comment on Facebook and on CTA YouTube channel. At the end, we're going to have this question and answer session as usual, where Sofia is going to answer all your questions. So don't be shy. Start now writing, say hi to us, let us know where you are connected from. And meanwhile, let me introduce Sofia. So let me invite her to join me here on the screen. Hi, Sofia, how are you?
Hi, Alba, fine, thanks.
Thanks a lot for participating today in this series. So before starting, let me introduce you to the people that doesn't know you. Sofia is a PhD student at the University of Siena, associated to the INFN in Pisa, in Italy. She is an active member of the MAGIC Collaboration and also the CTA Consortium. Particularly in the CTA Consortium, she works in the Physics Working Group that studies the Galactic Center. Her contribution in this richer field is focused on the study of the diffuse gamma ray emission from this particular region of our galaxy. So, Sofia, whenever you want, you're gonna start.
Okay. Hi, everybody. Today we are talking about our galaxy, the Milky Way, and in particular its extreme behavior, and what are the galactic sources responsible for this extreme behavior. Our journey through the Milky Way starts with a description of the night sky that we can see from the Earth, a brief description of our galaxy and its particular structures, and what are the stars responsible for this extreme behavior, in particular the massive stars. So we are talking about a bit about their birth, their evolution, and their death, is the so-called the supernova explosion. And later we are talking about a bit about the detection of the gamma rays at the ground with the Cherenkov telescopes, and how we can see the Milky Way as seen in gamma rays. So during the night, if we are in a rural space, we can see, and without the moon in the sky, we can see an arc-shaped region, a bright arc-shaped region, and this easy band of lights is our galaxy, the Milky Way. This is so bright because by naked eyes we can discriminate and resolve the individual stars. And essentially it is so bright because it is the center of our galaxy. And the particular shape is due to the fact that we are within the galaxy. And from the Earth's position, we can see 30 constellations in the sky. Here on the left, you can see a picture of our galaxy as seen by the Gaia satellite in the visible light. It is a map in galactic coordinates. So here in the center of this picture, there is this bright line, and it is our galactic plane. And in the center of this picture, there is the galactic center of the Milky Way. In 1610, Galilei, for the first time, resolved the bed of light into individual star with his telescopes. But we have to wait for Edwin Hubble in the 20th century to know that the Milky Way is just one of many galaxies in the universe. Indeed, until then, astronomers thought that all the stars in the universe belong to our galaxy, the Milky Way. The extension of the disk of our galaxy is about 50-60 kiloparsecs, and the thick of this disk is around 0.3 kiloparsecs. The mass of our galaxy is around 1 billion times the mass of our sun, and contain around several billions of stars and planets, because we know that each star has at least one planet or a planetary system. The Milky Way is a bare spiral galaxy with several satellite galaxies, such as the Large Magellanic Cloud and the Small Magellanic Cloud. And in the center, there is this bar-shaped core, and the origin and the nature of this bear-shaped structure is still under debate, but we know that it composed by dark matter, essentially. The Milky Way, together with the Andromeda Galaxy and the other galaxies, is part of the local group, and the local group is part of the Virgo Cluster, that is a component of the Lagnacéa Supercluster. Our solar system is around 8 kiloparsecs away from the galactic center. Our galaxy is composed by several bright regions in which there are a lot of stars, but also dark regions in which the dust obscures the light of the stars. There is also gas and dust, and they are the part of the so-called interstellar medium. At the center of our galaxy, there is a supermassive black hole. The name is Sagittarius A star, because it is toward the Sagittarius constellation. Here, and the mass of this supermassive black hole is several million times the mass of our star, of our sun. Here on the left, you can see a famous picture of the supermassive black hole of the galaxy M87, obtained with the Event Horizon Telescope in the radio regime. On the right side, instead, you can see a composite image of the galactic center region. And here you can see the stars and also the gas in this region, that is this diffuse light. Stars and gas orbit around the galactic center with a peculiar velocity and constant velocity, and that is in contrast with the Keplerian law. So we know from that, we know that at least the 90% of the mass of our galaxy is not visible to ordinary telescopes, and it is the evidence of the presence of dark matter. And maybe with telescopes such as CTA, we can detect the annihilation of dark matter that produce gamma rays, so we can hope to see that in the future. So, what are the sources responsible for this extreme behavior in our galaxy? Essentially, they are the stars, and in particular, the massive stars. So, a massive star born, a star in general, born in a stellar nebula or a molecular cloud, in which a protostar forms. After this stage, there is main sequence phase, that is the longest part of the lifetime of a star. And the lifetime of a massive star is several million years. It is not so long with respect to stellar like the Sun. And the massive stars are hot and bright stars with a fast rotation and so produce strong stellar winds. After this phase, we have the red supergiant phase, and after that, we have the death of the star in the so-called supernova explosion. After this transient event, we have the formation of two different compact objects, the neutron stars and the black hole. During the night, if we're looking at the constellation of Orion, the Orion constellation, we can see two bright stars, and the second brightest star is Betelgeuse. This star is important because it is in the red supergiant phase, and so we know that it is a precursor of a supernova explosion, and we hope to see a supernova explosion soon. Here you can see some picture of the European Southern Observatory about Betelgeuse. This star is important even because it is the second star after our Sun to be detected as an extended source. Otherwise, the stars are detected as point-like sources. On the right side, you can see an artistic impression of the dimension of Betelgeuse compared with the size of our solar system. On the right side, you can see the scale and the size of our solar system in astronomical units. And on the left side, the comparison of the size of our solar system, but instead of astronomical units in Betelgeuse radii. The majority of the stars and also the massive stars are in binary systems. And here you can see a picture of the Big Dipper and the zoom on these two stars, this binary system, the Mizar and Argo. But what is the step after the explosion of a star? So we have the so-called supernova event, and in particular we are interested in the second type of supernova event because we are interested in the death of the massive star. So they are the so-called core collapse supernova because the star sudden collapse in a compact object. They are important because there is the injection into the space of iron and heavier nuclei, and also the acceleration of particles, the so-called cosmic rays. Here you can see a picture of the latest supernova exploded in 1987. And this supernova is important because we can observe it since the explosion of the stars, and so we can study the evolution of this phase. After the supernova explosion, there is the so-called supernova remnant. And here you can see three famous examples in our galaxy of supernova remnant. From the left, we can see the Crab Nebula, and in the middle, the Tycho Nebula, and on the right side, you can see Cassiopeia E, that is an old supernova remnant in the Cassiopeia constellation. These objects are important in the energy astrophysics because they are characterized by strong shock waves that accelerate cosmic rays that interacting with the surrounding gas and the interstellar medium, and this interaction produce gamma rays that we can observe with gamma rays observatories. One of the products of the supernova explosion is the neutron stars. They are compact objects, and they are the core collapse of a massive star, in particular a metal-rich star. They are the smallest and densest known objects because their density is comparable with the density of atomic nuclei. The mass of this object is not so big. It is a bit larger than that of the Sun. But the radius of this this source is very, very small, around 10 kilometers. So for that reason, they are the densest object known. These sources are mainly composed by neutrons, so from that the name of this neutron star, and they are fast rotator. This is an important feature, as we can see later. We know that in our galaxy there are around 1 billion of neutron stars. Pulsars are a particular kind of neutron stars. They are pulsating radio source, so they are visible in the radio regime, and they have a precise rotational period, so they are precise clock, and we can use them as clock. The emission is from the poles from these sources, and that produce the so-called lighthouse-like radiation and effect, as we see later. Another subclass of pulsars is the millisecond pulsars. They are extremely important in the high-energy astrophysics because produce radio as the pulsars, but also X-rays and gamma rays. Essentially, they are old neutron stars in binary systems. Here you can see an animation of a pulsar, in particular of a binary pulsar. And here you can see this emission, this jet escaping from the poles of the stars. And when this jet points toward us, we can have this the so-called lighthouse effect. Another important object and extreme object in our galaxy is a globular cluster. It is a spheroidal banded region with a lot of stars and also millisecond pulsars. So for that, it is expected to be a gamma ray emitter. It is a bright region because there are a lot of stars, so for that reason it is bright. And also these objects are typically located in the galactic halo, so in the outer part of our Milky Way, and they are constituted by old stars like in the galactic center. The core of this object is extremely compact, so we know that at the center there is the presence of dark matter. And so also for that we hope to detect very high energy emission from the annihilation of dark matter in the center of this region. As stars, also pulsars are in binary system. As I said before, binary systems are extremely important in the very high energy astrophysics, and because they emit X-rays and gamma rays, but also are important in the multi-messenger studies because emit gravitational waves. One important event associated with binary system is the so-called kilonova. It is a transient event that occurs in a compact binary when two objects merge and after collapse in a black hole. And this phenomenon emits gravitational wave, then so-called short gamma ray burst. That is a fast emission of gamma rays in a short time. Another kind of neutron stars are the so-called magnetars, characterized by a strong magnetic field, and the decay of these magnetic fields generates emission in the X-rays and in gamma rays. The other product of the supernova explosion is the black hole. It is a region of the space-time in which the gravity is so strong that prevents everything to escape, also the light. So from that the name black holes. We know that a compact object can modify the space-time and so form a black hole. The last boundary of no escape is the so-called event horizon, and we can detect black holes since they interact with ordinary matter, forming an accretion disk. that emits in the whole electromagnetic spectrum, also in gamma rays. Also, black holes are in binary system, and in the center of the galaxies, there are the supermassive black holes, like in our galaxy, the Sagittarius A star. Another important object in the energy astrophysics are the stellar wind clusters and also the star forming region. Here you can see some examples. On the top, left and right, you can see two examples of stellar wind clusters, one in the south hemisphere and one in the north hemisphere. And on the bottom, instead, you can see a star forming region in the LMC, already detected in the gamma rays. These regions are important because occurs particle acceleration and so with gamma ray emission. But how we can detect gamma rays at very high energy from the ground of the Earth? We know that when an energetic photon hits the top of our atmosphere, generate an electromagnetic cascade that generates the so-called Cherenkov light. And at the ground, it spread in the so-called pool. And within this pool, we have put our Cherenkov telescopes to detect this light. It is important to detect gamma rays because from that we can know exactly the position of the source. Instead, for instance, with cosmic rays, we have no information about the position of the source. On the right side, you can see a picture of the first LST, large size telescope of the Cherenkov telescope array, located at La Palma in Canary Island. This picture was taken by the postdoc Serena Loporchio. She made her shift for taking data in the last weeks. So as I showed before, here there is the picture of our galaxy as seen by the Gaia telescopes. So through eye sensible to the visible light. And here instead we have the Milky Way, but as seen in gamma rays. So if we have eyes sensible to gamma ray, we can see the Milky Way in this way. Here there is at the center this red line that is essentially the diffuse emission due to the cosmic rays accelerated in the sources I described before and interacted with the interstellar medium in our galaxy and produced this diffuse gamma ray emission. Here there are two examples of objects detected in our galaxy. On the left side, there is an artistic impression of the so-called Fermi bubble detected by the NASA Fermi LAT satellite, that is a telescope orbiting around the Earth. And the origin of and the nature of this structure is still under debate, but we know that they are the relic of a past active phase of our galaxy. On the left side, instead, you can see the S-Galactic Plane Survey, and in particular, another view of our galactic plane as seen at TV Energies by the S telescopes, that is currently operating Cherenkov telescopes in Namibia. Here, there is another example related with our galactic center. In particular, on the left side, you can see the map and the detection of the so-called central molecular zone, that is the inner part of the galactic center, composed by dense gas and by this central source, that is essentially our supermassive black hole, as seen by the S telescopes. On the right side, instead, you can see a simulation of what CTA we will be see, and we hope to see that with the upcoming Cherenkov telescope array. Here we have a picture of the TV catalog. This is the catalog of TV sources detected so far with the currently operating Cherenkov telescopes, such as HESS, Veritas and MAGIC. And one of the goals of CTA is to improve the population of this TV catalog, both in the galactic plane, but also in the extragalactic sky. So this is the end of our journey through the Milky Way. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Sophia. It was extremely nice presentation. It was a full and detailed trip through the sources that are in our galaxy that usually we think about the normal stars like our sun, and they are really special sources like the pulsars you show there, and obviously black holes. So thanks a lot for this presentation. So we're going to start now with the question and answer session. So to all participants, if you have any comment, question, curiosity, as I mentioned in the beginning, this is the moment. Leave a comment on Facebook, on our YouTube channel. Sophia will answer it. But meanwhile, let me ask you a question, Sophia. So we show some extreme sources, but then you talk about some regions that look more still, let's say, such as the stellar wind clusters or the star-forming regions. And you mentioned that these regions were interesting for CTAO, for the observatory, because they are gamma ray emitters, they can accelerate particles. But I wonder how they can accelerate particles, because they look like a, let's say, normal region. So I don't know if you can comment on this.
Yes, in particular, stellar wind clusters are important because, as I said before, massive stars are faster rotators and so produce strong stellar winds. And in this cluster, in which there are a lot of these massive stars, when these strong winds interact with each other, and at the determination, there are some termination shock in this region. And so this is a particular region in which the acceleration of particles occur. So for that reason, we know that they are gamma ray emitters, at least at GV energies, MEV energies. But there are evidence that they are interesting also in the TV regime. So we hope to detect them with the CTA, with the CTA, especially in the north and also in the south atmosphere hemisphere.
Perfect. Thanks a lot. Okay.
Instead, in the star-forming region, we have in this region there are it is the place in which the star burns. So we have supernova explosion and also the birth of new stars. And so, as I said before, here we have a strong acceleration, for that reason, emission of gamma rays.
So all the supernova, kilonova, GRVs that you showed in the talk.
Yes, because essentially the lifetime of a massive star is short. So when a massive star explodes in a supernova, in the place in which it explodes, there is the surrounding gas of the molecular clouds originates new stars. So this is a perfect environment in which there is a supernova explosion, so shocks, and also the presence of a lot of materials and cosmic rays that are accelerated in these shock waves can interact with this medium and generate gamma rays.
Perfect, thanks. Okay, so I do not see more comments. I think you were extremely clear, actually, in your presentation. So thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Okay, there is one. David, okay. I'm going to put it here. David says, sorry if I miss it, but Could and does the CTA detect Pegatron energies?
Yes, one of the goals of the CTA is the detection of the so-called pevatrons. So far, we know that the supernova is the major accelerator for the cosmic rays, but so far, none of the known supernova shows a pevatron behavior. But there are some candidates, such as the Galactic Center, and also the compact stellar wind clusters. They are candidates for this pevatron emission. So we hope that with the Cherenkov telescope array, we can detect this source in the energy regime that is obscured so far by the currently Cherenkov telescopes. And because it is important, because if we can detect the spectrum of this source, and if we can detect the so-called cutoff of this source, we are sure that it is or not a pevatron without the use of models, because so far this interpretation of pevatron are based on just on models. Instead, we hope that in future we can detect the emission and the so-called cutoff, and so this is the evidence of the presence of a pevatron or not.
Well, maybe it's worth mentioning that the observatory reaches 300 tera electron volts, but what Sofia was mentioned, the pevatrons, they are these kind of cosmic sources that accelerate particles, no, up to these pevatron energies. But the gamma rays, which are the, let's say, the product of these particles, they do not reach pevatrons, the ones that CTO is going to observe, right?
Yeah, yes. Yes, the pevatron energies is related to the primary particles, so the primary, essentially, protons of cosmic rays, and the related secondary emission in the gamma rays is at least a factor of 10 less than the primary cosmic rays. So the name of the pevatron is due to the fact that the primary cosmic rays are accelerated at that energies. But yes, for sure, we can detect emission at some hundreds of TV.
It's a cool name, though, pevatrons. Okay, so now I do not see more comments. Okay, so I would say we leave it here, and if somebody has more comments, you can leave them in the comment sections of our Facebook and YouTube channel. We can have a look later and answer them. Sofia will answer those.
Yes.
But from now, let's stop here. A reminder for everybody, this is our latest webinar before the summer break. So we are not going to have a webinar on August. We see you again in September, and we are going beyond our galaxy. We're going to go on a trip through the extragalactic universe. We're going to see the extreme and distant galaxies that we can observe. So don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and subscribe here on YouTube to stay tuned. So Sofia, thanks again for participating and for the wonderful webinar.
Thank you very much.
And thank you to all attendees. See you in the next event. Ciao, ciao.
See you, bye, ciao.